So just as an icebreaker, I'd be sharing my screen one second. So I think the participants who joined us for all our sessions will be familiar with this. Jonathan has put the link in the chat box, so if you could use that and answer the question, have you been to a fish landing center? So we have about three questions, just an icebreaker to get an idea. Okay, so 80% if you have not been. Okay, it's shifting. Eight of you have answered the question. I think we have around 40 participants, so if you could all answer, it would be great. Okay. I think the majority looks like majority of you have not been to a landing center. Okay. Okay, so I think we can so majority is no. So we can go to the next question. Can you let me know if you have seen any marine animal and where and what which animal it was? Just to get an idea, just to find out what you've seen and where. It can be a fish or anything that you've seen. If you have an aquarium, okay, fish. Yeah, that's. What else? What interesting things have you seen? Goldfish, seal, okay. If anybody has an aquarium, you can put that also. Like, I have a pet fish or an aquarium. Jellyfish, okay. Corals, that's great. Dolphin, okay, wow. Sharks, great. Starfish, sea turtle, green turtle, okay. Tortoise. Tortoise is not a marine animal, it's terrestrial, so. Fish, turtles, dolphins. Okay, great. Seagull. That's. Few more answers. Dolphin is the maximum, is it? I held a starfish. Okay, great. Okay. Peacock mussel. Okay, wow, nice. Crab. That's good. Sea cucumber. This is a nice. I think we have a good crowd. We've seen a lot of dead puffer fishes. Okay, we can ask you why. Where did you see it? Crabs, otters. Okay, great. So I think then we'll go to the next question. What do you think are the main threats to a marine and freshwater environment? So if you can answer that also, this will be the final question. And then we'll proceed with the session. Plastic pollution, okay, that's a true. Motor boats, fishing gear, sea erosion, underwater sound waves, that's a very good answer. Trawling, plastics and polythene, oil spills, a lot of good answers. Trawling. Modern boats, okay, probably. Human activities, yeah, I think that sums up all the most of our threats. Microplastics, that's very true. Sand mining, okay. Loss of habitat, that's very true. Industrial activities, yeah. Fishing nets, you mean ghost fishing nets or fragmentation destruction, yes. Okay, so I think climate change, yes, that's very true. Light pollution, yeah, that's also a good answer. Overfishing, yes. Okay, so I think I'll stop my screen and then before I give the floor to the speakers, I'd like to just talk to you about in the context of post 2020. So I just wanted to say that oceans and seas are an integral part of the global climate system, and they play a very important role in absorbing the heat and carbon dioxide which makes our planet habitable. So these water bodies produce about half of the world's oxygen, and this influences the temperature and rainfall patterns that we see. And coastal areas also support a lot of communities, and the ecosystem they provide, the ecosystem benefits that they provide, like coastal stabilization, regulation of coastal water, spawning areas for a lot of species, are also, they provide a lot of benefits. And human actions are radically changing the marine environment, so which is resulting in like increased sea surface temperatures, changing ocean circulation, chemistry, change in thermal stratification, biogeochemical cycles, and even the, generally the distribution patterns of a lot of ecologically important species. And one of the main reasons is direct exploitation, such as overfishing. And even the, another strong driver is the land and sea use change. Pollution and climate change will come after these two. So some of the policies that are relevant to the global biodiversity framework in the marine realm include the biodiversity beyond national jurisdiction of the UN Convention on the Law of Sea, International Whaling Commission, and the FAO Code of Conduct for Fisheries. A target of 30% of marine habitat through context-appropriate area-based conservation measures by 2030 is also under consideration. This is important because the previous Aichi targets of, for 2020 to conserve 10% of the marine and coastal ecosystems and 17% of terrestrial and inland waters was not expected to be met even by December 2020 based on the IPBS Global Assessment Report. With ocean acidification fast emerging as a substantial threat to marine conservation, talks are ongoing for its inclusion in the post-2020. And the zero draft of post-2020 global biodiversity talks, specifically about marine and freshwater conservation, and two of its 2030 action targets and 2050 goals, talk about two main goals, which is restoring biodiversity loss, and that talks about retaining and restoring freshwater, marine and terrestrial ecosystems. And they also aim to achieve no net loss by 2030 in area and in the area and integrity of freshwater. So I'd like Priyansh to introduce our first speaker, Ms. Trisha Gupta. So Priyansh, if you could.
Am I audible?
Yeah,
we can. So good evening, everyone. I feel privileged to introduce you all to our first speaker of the day, who is Ms. Trisha Gupta. Ms. Trisha Gupta is a marine biologist and researcher pursuing her PhD at the University of Oxford and is also the hub manager at Conservation Optimism India. Conservation Optimism is a global community dedicated to sharing optimistic stories and resources to empower people from all backgrounds to make a positive impact for wildlife and nature. Last year, Conservation Optimism started its India Hub and have published a lot of positive stories in the field of conservation in India. Prior to joining as a PhD student, Trisha worked as assistant researcher at Dakshin Foundation, where she headed the flagship species program on elasmobranch and fisheries along the Indian coast. She has worked closely with the fishing communities in India and is interested in using interdisciplinary approaches to conserve marine life and ecosystems while balancing the livelihood needs of coastal communities. Indian Youth Biodiversity Network is privileged to have you today in the session. I would now request you to start the session.
Thank you so much, Priyansh, for the introduction, and thank you to the Indian Biodiversity Youth Network for inviting me here to be a speaker. I'm really excited for this talk. So I'm just going to share a link on the chat, just like the little interactive activities that you've already done that Sudha led you through. I have one small activity for you guys as well. So if you could just click on the link, and what I want you to do is think about what your idea is of conservation, especially of conservation of oceans and freshwater ecosystems. And when you think of this conservation, what do you think? What do you think about it? What is your idea of aquatic conservation? What are the things that come to your mind? It could be something like having clean oceans, or it could be something like healthy fish populations, or whatever it is that comes to your mind. And just write it down in the little chat box, the little boxes that are provided, and then we can see what people think when it comes to ocean conservation. So I'll just give you guys a few minutes to complete this. So just write down whatever your thoughts are when it comes to conservation of oceans and freshwater habitats. If anybody's having trouble accessing the link, you can just put it on the chat box if you really can't put it on the link. Okay, so I'm just going to share my screen and show you the results. Okay, can you guys see this? So we have a lot of different thoughts and answers coming up. I'm just trying to go through, but it seems like healthy reefs, clean oceans, biodiversity are some of the popular ideas that we think of when we think of ocean and freshwater conservation. There's also mindful of our choices, avoid overfishing, healthy marine ecosystems, clean rivers, no rise in temperature, community involvement, nice, sustainable lifestyle, saving animals, sustainable harvest, healthy coral reefs, no pollution. Yeah. So this is really great to get all of these different thoughts. I'm just going to share a PowerPoint right now. Okay. So personally, for me, when I first started working in the field of marine biology, my idea of conservation was this picture that you see right here in front of you. So it was this idea of having these really beautiful and pristine ecosystems with these lovely coral reefs supporting a huge range of biodiversity in the oceans, and an ecosystem that is completely untouched by any human influences. So when I first started doing my degree in marine biology, this is the idea that I had in mind, and this is what I thought that I would spend my career working towards. But this image changed a bit after I finished my degree, and I first started interning with an organization on the west coast of India on a project. And this project involved working very closely alongside fishing communities. So I saw a very different picture of the ocean than that I had previously had in mind. A picture where you have people and fishing communities that on a very daily basis interact with the oceans. These communities depend on these oceans, on these water bodies for their food, for their livelihoods, and their entire way of life. And then I started to realize that it's not just fishing communities or coastal communities, but it's all people, all of us in some way or the other, directly or indirectly, we do depend on the oceans for our survival for many, many different ways. And in such a context, it doesn't really make sense to remove us humans out of the equation. So when we think about conservation, it needs to include the humans as well. So that's when my idea of conservation, especially conservation of the oceans, slowly started to change and shift towards something that is a bit more inclusive of people and that is not just about nature, but about people as well. So I started to realize that when we talk about conservation, it is about protecting marine biodiversity and marine habitats and any kind of natural habitat in general, but at the same time, it's also about making sure that these habitats and this biodiversity can still support our needs and ensuring that we have a sustainable relationship with the oceans and can live in harmony with it. So I realize that the people are a really important factor here that we can't just cut out or remove. And this is what I'm hoping to talk to you guys about a bit more about today and discuss in further detail. So in the talk today, I'll talk to you a bit about this idea of marine conservation that includes people and how we can think about and balance both aspects of biodiversity as well as people when it comes to conservation. And I'm going to talk about this using one of my case studies, a project that I worked on shark and reef fisheries. And after that, we can talk a bit more about the youth and the role of youth in India when it comes to conservation of our aquatic systems. So to start off with, what are sharks and rays? So sharks and rays are nothing but a group of fish. They're a group of cartilaginous fish, which means that their internal skeleton is made up of cartilage instead of bone. And they're a highly diverse group of fish. So there are more than 1,100 species of sharks and rays found all across the oceans or across the world. And I don't give an exact number because we still don't really know how many species are out there, and we're still discovering new species. They're also a very highly threatened group of species, unfortunately. Sharks and rays are now considered to be one of the most threatened animal groups in the world today. And the reason for this is that they have certain biological characters and life history characters that make them very vulnerable to all kinds of different threats. So all of the different threats that you guys listed in the activity that Sudha made you do, the threats to the oceans, they affected, these species are affected by all of these different threats, and they're not able to recover very fast from these threats. But one thing that makes it even more challenging for their conservation is that they are a commercially valuable species group. So these species are fished all across the world. They do form an important resource. So their conservation does become a bit more difficult. Coming to the context of India, India is actually amongst the top three shark and ray fishing nations. And by this, I mean in terms of the actual amount of sharks and rays that are captured and sold in the country, we are usually between second and third position all across the world, which may be surprising to some of you because you probably haven't even heard of sharks and rays being fished in the country. But it's true that, yeah, we do catch a large amount of them. And just to give you an idea, in the 1990s, on average, we would catch at least 50 to 70,000 tons of sharks and rays every single year. The number is probably higher than this because there's a lot of the catch that isn't properly recorded. So as you can imagine, this is quite a massive number and it's quite a huge quantity. So it's not surprising that after the 1990s, from the early 2000s onwards, the catches of these species slowly started to decline in India, even though our fishing effort was actually increasing. So this clearly gave an indication that populations of these species are in trouble and we need to do something about it. So with this information in mind, I started working on a project a few years ago alongside Dakshin Foundation in a small town called Malvan. So Malvan is this beautiful little coastal town that's found on the west coast of India, if you've ever been lucky enough to be there. And it's in the south of Maharashtra, actually. So it's a lovely coastal town, and it's also a major fishing center. So Malvan has a huge diversity of different fisheries that operate in this region, from really small scale traditional fishing boats that you see here on the front of the picture to these large scale, larger trawler boats that you see at the back. And all of them operate in this space. So from previous studies, we had heard that there is a substantial amount of shark and rays being captured in this region. So we decided to do a project on it and find out a bit more and get some baseline information about the kind of species that are found in this region, where are they getting captured from, how are they getting captured and why. So after a couple of years of monitoring their fisheries and recording these species, we found that there is indeed quite a significant amount of catch of sharks and rays in this region. And we also realized that a lot of the catch is actually through something called bycatch, which if some of you may be not familiar with the term, but bycatch basically means that these species were captured when a fishing boat is out fishing for another species like shrimp or pomfret, for example. And in the process, they almost accidentally catch a shark or a ray in their nets. But of course, they bring it back and sell it anyway because it is commercially valuable. So there is quite a lot of bycatch of these species in this region. And another thing we realized is that very often you get a lot of juveniles, that is young individuals being captured. So the species that you see in this picture are, I think, common black-tip sharks. And these, even though they don't look very small, are actually newborn individuals. So they were caught one morning in a fishing net and then brought back and sold. And it was quite hard for us as a research team to sometimes see these young babies of this very threatened species being captured and sold like this on a very regular basis. But at the same time, we were understanding that there was a larger story to this problem. So when it comes to sharks and rays, they are quite commercially important in this region, and they also form an important food source. So this woman that you see in the picture, she's a fish trader, and she very often buys these small sized shark and ray species that you see in the picture, and she sells them to a lot of households in this region. And they form an important food source because they are often sold for a very low price. They're cheaper than most other fish species. So they do form a very easily available and cheap food source for many households. And at the same time, they do contribute to the income of the traders like this woman that you see here and to all of the fishers who sell them in the first place. So we realized that it was really important to understand all of these factors and to keep it in mind when we're thinking of shark and ray conservation, because obviously we don't want to have a huge impact on the lives and the food needs of these people. So with that in mind, the next step of our project looked at how we can possibly reduce bycatch of sharks and rays in this region. So we developed a number of possible hypothetical measures that we can reduce their bycatch and conserve these species. And this was a collaborative study that was done with Oxford University. So some of these measures were, one, to try and close certain fishing grounds during a certain season where it seemed that there were higher catches of sharks and rays being recorded. The second would be to restrict the use of certain fishing nets where we saw a high catch of juvenile sharks and rays. The third would be to use something called bycatch reduction devices, which are these special devices that allow the escape of species once they're being captured in the net. And the fourth option would be that the fishermen release live juvenile sharks and rays once they're being captured back into the water. So we did a lot of analyses on our data to understand how effective each of these measures would be when it comes to actually reducing the catch and mortality of these species. But more importantly, we realized that we needed to work with the local community. So we conducted interviews with the fishermen as well to understand their perspectives of these different bycatch measures and to see if any of these measures would have an impact on their catch and then on their earnings, and if they would even follow these measures if they were to be implemented. So what we learned is that our data showed that when it comes to reducing bycatch and mortality of sharks and rays, the first option would be the most effective, because closing a fishing ground would mean that there would be a large number of these species that would get conserved. But at the same time, when we spoke to fishermen, we got quite a different story, because what the fishermen told us is that this measure would have a huge impact on their earnings, because if a fishing ground is closed, they wouldn't necessarily know where to go instead, and it could be a huge loss for them. And they told us that if such a measure was implemented, they wouldn't want to follow it and there could be a lot of conflict. What they told us instead is that the last measure that we proposed, which was to release these juveniles and baby sharks and rays live from the fishing boats back into the water, would be something that they would be willing to do, because it would have a very small impact on their earnings and it was something that they could do easily and they were happy to follow it if it was to be implemented. So that's when we realized that even though this wasn't the most effective option when it comes to reducing the catch and mortality of these species, it was the most feasible option because the fishing community could actually be willing to follow it. So when it comes to marine conservation, we often think of, we only think of measures such as marine protected areas or closing down fishing grounds that again tend to be the measures that we remove humans from the equation and remove humans from these habitats and don't let them access it. And in many cases in the world, this has worked and it can work, but it doesn't always work in every circumstance, especially in a country like India. So our study showed us that if we instead work alongside the fishing community and include them in the decision-making, we can develop measures and strategies that would work for both the people as well as for biodiversity. So this was just a small but hopefully positive step in the right direction that showed us what we need to do next when it comes to shark and ray conservation and general marine conservation in this region. So now I'm going to come to talking about the role of youth in India when it comes to conservation, especially conservation of our marine aquatic habitats. So in India, unfortunately, historically, our oceans and our freshwater habitats have not received the same kind of attention as our terrestrial habitats, because there's been a lot of research work, conservation work that's happened on terrestrial ecosystems and on large charismatic terrestrial species, but not the same kind of attention on our oceans and freshwater habitats. But luckily, this is changing. More and more people are getting interested in the oceans, getting interested in rivers and lakes, and conducting more research on these habitats, more research on the ecosystems, the species, the human interactions with these spaces. And more people are now working towards their conservation. And this is largely because of the youth, because we are a generation who is very interested, very excited about these different regions, excited to explore these different areas and work towards their conservation. So when it comes to youth, especially students, what can you do if you want to contribute towards conservation of oceans and freshwater habitats? So there's a lot of things, and a few of them I can talk about now, which is, if you're a student especially, I would really encourage you to try and intern and volunteer as much as you can. There's so many different projects happening all across the country, so many things that are very interesting and very relevant. And as researchers, we always need help. For example, my project in Malvern, for over 3 years, we had so many interns and volunteers helping us out, and I honestly couldn't have done it without them. So I think that if you get any opportunities, you really should go for it and try to help out, because not only will it be a learning experience for you, but you will also contribute a lot to the research and conservation efforts happening in the country. Another thing that I want to talk to you about is sustainable seafood. So I'm sure a lot of us here, a lot of you guys in the audience, are people who like to eat seafood, who enjoy eating fish. But the more you hear about the kind of impacts fishing may have on the oceans and on marine life, you may start to question and wonder if fish is something that you should continue to eat. Is it still a good idea to consume seafood? So the key here is to be a bit more sustainable and a bit more conscious when it comes to your seafood choices. And there are a few initiatives that can help you with this. So you may have come across these initiatives, such as Know Your Fish and In-Season Fish. And if you haven't, I'd really strongly encourage you to check out their websites, check them out on Instagram and wherever else you would like to. So what these initiatives do is that they produce these calendars every month that they produce based on the biology and breeding habitats and fishing information of different seafood species. And what they do is they provide recommendations in terms of what species is relatively safer to consume and what species you should avoid for that month based on the kind of environmental impact it has. So it's, again, a small step in the right direction. And even if you don't consume seafood yourself, you can also tell your friends, your family, and other people who do consume seafood to follow these different calendars and try to make more sustainable choices. And I think the last thing that I would like to say is one really important thing that we can do as the youth of this country is just to raise your voice. Especially in a day like this, in an age like this, where social media and digital platforms are becoming more and more important, more and more relevant when it comes to taking action and making change, just to raise your voice, to spread awareness and to do things on these digital platforms can make a huge difference. For example, there's a Conservation Optimism India platform that was mentioned earlier that I'm a part of this group, and we try to do a lot of different work to try and raise awareness on the different environmental issues and ocean issues that are happening across the country and spread these positive messages and try to encourage people to participate and make a difference. There's also there are a lot of different initiatives. I've just mentioned a few here, but Let India Breathe is another very famous platform that has been doing a lot of work when it comes to a lot of environmental related issues in the country. So you don't obviously have to create your own platform necessarily, but just by engaging with these existing platforms or just by spreading awareness amongst just your friends and family and try and, I don't know, raise your voice, you can make a huge difference and really contribute to the conservation efforts of this country. So that's it from me. Thank you all so much for listening. And thank you once again to the Indian Youth Biodiversity Network for inviting me here. I'd like to give a quick shout out to the different funding agencies and organizations who supported my work so far. And I've also provided my email address and Twitter and Instagram handles. So if anybody would like to contact me, if they have any questions or comments, I'm happy to answer them. So that's it from me. I'm going to stop sharing now. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Trisharan. That was a wonderful talk. And now we'll have a Q&A after Stella also gives her talk. So I'd request Priyansh to introduce Stella and then Stella can take over. Thank you.
So moving forward to our next speaker, I am honored to introduce you all to Ms. Stella Jain. Ms. Stella is an environmental lawyer, researcher, and a storyteller. Since completing her law degree, she has worked closely with local communities to facilitate the strengthening of their decision-making in environmental governance. She has worked with and for the Adivasi community in Orissa around mining and forest degradation with natural justice. She has also worked with the fisherfolk communities of Lakshadweep on changing reef fisheries and climate change during her time with the Nature Conservation Foundation. Her work also involved facilitating multi-stakeholder dialogue in building a community-led sustainable reef fisheries. She then worked at Equations with the coastal communities and civil society organizations to understand blue economy and tourism, and to understand the impacts of tourism on coastal Samans. She is also a storyteller and believes that the world can be best understood through the stories we tell ourselves and each other. She has a keen interest in facilitating the strengthening of local governance and decision-making structures for effective governance of natural landscapes. Today, the Indian Youth Biodiversity Network is delighted by your presence in our session. I would now request Stella ma'am to enlighten us with her words on today's theme.
Thank you so much for that very kind introduction, Priyansh. And I'm absolutely honored to be doing this session today. And I'm very glad to hear and see what the kind of work that the Global Youth Biodiversity Network and the IYBN is doing as well. And I also really want to thank Trisha for putting in a very good context to the marine ecosystem, because I think that context, especially her understanding that she gave about the linkage between communities and marine ecosystems, I think is really going to form the basis of what I'm going to talk to you guys about as well. So I'm just going to share a presentation. Can you guys see the presentation? Okay, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the legal aspects about coastal governance. I'm not going to go a lot into the details of the different laws, but I will talk a little bit more about the larger sort of issues with coastal governance in India. And I'm sorry, but my story isn't as optimistic and hopeful as Trisha's has been, but I really hope that it's a story that encourages all of you to given more time to the coastal space, because it's really in need of that. So just before going into the complexities, I'm going to start with a very quick overview of the umbrella of legislations that govern coastal and marine ecosystems. The first is the Environment Protection Act 1986, and specifically under the EPA, there is the Coastal Regulation Zone notification, the first of which was passed in 1991. And the CRZ essentially legally defines what a coast is. So it says that a coastal zone is 12 nautical miles into the water, then your area between the low tide and the high tide line, which is your intertidal zone, and from the high tide line to 500 meters landward. So this is a sort of space that is called the coast. Additionally, it also includes tidal influenced water bodies, which are things like backwaters, where again, it's the water itself, the intertidal area of the backwater of the intertidal water, and 100 meters on the other side, on each side. I'll go a little bit more into the coastal regulation zone notification itself. But one of the most important things is that the CRZ is currently the most important legislation that exists for preservation of the coastal and marine ecosystem in the country today. But it's not the only one. There are a few other legislations that complement the CRZ. The first is the Wildlife Protection Act and the Biodiversity Act, both of which are applicable to both terrestrial areas and to marine systems as well. The WLPA, as you know, protects protects species, and it doesn't like it protects certain species under its schedule, and this includes marine species like dolphins and like turtles, etc. The Biodiversity Act, among other things, it requires the formation of local biodiversity management committees, which are then required to document and to manage and protect biodiversity, which includes marine biodiversity as well. Then you have a host of fisheries acts. These are passed by each state government. And the fisheries acts include everything from licensing of boats, what kind of gear can be used, which areas can you fish in, which seasons can you fish in. So all of that comes under the fisheries acts. Similarly, you have a range of those things for shipping acts, which are the same thing for shipping. So, you know, everything from licensing of cargo, passenger, cruise ships, cargo fees, what shipping routes different vessels can take, etc. You have the Atomic Energy Act, which regulates mining. This is rare earth minerals that are taken from sand, from beach sand, which include things like plutonium and thorium and a couple of these atomic minerals that are taken from beach areas. And you have a bunch of pollution laws. Now, what these laws do is, first of all, they establish institutions like the Fisheries Department, MOEF, and at local levels, there are authorities like Chilika Development Authority. And second of all, they ensure, they sort of keep put in place practices and rules, like the Fisheries Acts and the CRZ notifications that we were just talking about. Now, all of this is happening at the government level, at the central and the state government levels. But there are also institutions and practices and rules which happen at the community level. So, for example, there are what are called Oor Panchayats in Tamil Nadu, and a system that doesn't exist so much anymore, but is called Kadakodi in Kerala. And both of these are institutions that are made by fish workers to govern how they're going to, you know, it regulates fishing, it regulates usage of the marine spaces. Similarly, you have practices and rules. So for example, there is a system in Minicoy, which is an island in Lakshadweep, which is a quota system, where how that works is that Minicoy is a coral atoll. So there are different reefs, like the reef has different sort of boulders, coral boulders, and each boat is sort of assigned one particular boulder, and they can only fish in that season. They can only fish on that particular boulder. So what this means is that it's sort of like a it works like a regulation of how much fish will be taken, because if a boat overfishes on that reef, then like they're done for the season, and then they have no more fish to eat or sell. This is an old sort of traditional system that has existed. There are also newer systems. Trisha spoke about how they've worked on establishing rules around sharks and rays. So similarly, there is a system in Rameshwaram in Tamil Nadu in the Gulf of Mannar, where there are women seaweed collectors who, you know, they go to the sea near the Gulf of Mannar area, which is also a coral area. They dive into the water, they free dive into the water, and they pick seaweed. And in the early 2000s, they started working with a conservation NGO to establish rules around that seaweed collection. So that has included things like they only collect seaweed for about, they don't collect seaweed for 12 days in a month to allow regeneration of the seaweed. They also don't use metal scrapers. They'll only use their hand because the metal scrapers can destroy corals. So these are a few examples, but there are several such examples of both old systems and, you know, evolving systems of practices and institutions around marine governance. And this is, to me, I just want to, lay out a framework that I like using to understand how environmental governance works or doesn't work, I don't agree with the framework, it is to think of the marine ecosystem as a resource base where different kinds of actors are laying claims on the same resource base. So these can be different kinds of non-human actors. So for example, pelagic birds want fish, or corals want sunlight, etc., right? And so that constitutes the entire realm of the rights of nature jurisprudence that I think you guys have done one session on, if I'm not wrong. But what I will talk to you today about is the human actors and the kind and the negotiation between the different human actors. So within the human actors, again, Trisha has spoken a little bit about this, but you have claims made by, say, fish workers who want fish, who want space on the beach to dry their nets or to repair, to store their boats or to dry fish. So all of that is required by the fishing industry, by fish workers. You have other claims like the real estate industry wants prime location with a sea view location. The tourism industry wants hotels, wants infrastructure in coastal areas. You have others like the thermal power industry that needs water. You have textile industry. So there are a lot of different kinds of claims that are made on the coastal and marine resource base. And what the law does is to negotiate between these claims and to decide who gets what and how much of it do all of them get. And here I come to some of the problems with the way the current governance is happening, which is that the current marine governance system in India has consistently and systematically, it has prioritized industries and money over people and nature. And this is to me the biggest problem, that in this negotiation, it is always, almost always, the industry that seems to win. And what this leads to is, one, the alienation of communities from nature. By this, I mean that communities lose access to land where they live. They lose access to fishing grounds. They lose access to food security. They lose access to clean water. So they lose access to nature because of this kind of prioritization. At the same time, nature is alienated from communities. What I mean by this is that all of those community-based systems that I spoke about, the institutions and the practices and rules that are followed, none of them are formally recognized within the governance system in India. It doesn't recognize them, it doesn't integrate them. So the use of nature, the use of the marine ecosystem is then taken away from communities and is given to the central and state governments, many of which are sitting far away from the coastal spaces themselves. And this is done in two ways. One is by passing certain laws. So let's look at just one example of this, which is the CRZ notification. Now, this is the difference between the CRZ notification in 2011, which was brought out after a lot of consultation with a lot of different stakeholders. And this is 2019, which is the latest CRZ notification that works. And you can see the kind of dilutions that are there. So if you look at, say, CRZ-4, which is the water area, you can see that there are a lot more activities that are allowed in the CRZ-4 than were allowed in 2011. You can see that the no development zone, the NDZ, in certain areas has been reduced from 200 meters to 50 meters. It doesn't say so here, but in the CRZ-1A areas, which are eco-sensitive areas, there are certain kinds of tourism that have been allowed in the 2019 notification that weren't allowed in 2011 notification. And so similarly, the CRZ is not the only law that has gone through this kind of dilution. This has consistently happened to several other legislations as well. But more importantly, I think what has been the dominant way of governance has been de facto, which is that it is either that violations are not taken into effect. I mean, actions are taken on violations of CRZ, judgments are not implemented. There are, you know, exclusions given to industries. And in a lot of cases, it's this situation where things just sort of, they just sort of happen. There's nothing technically, legally to stop them. There's nothing technically to stop them, but also there isn't anything technically to allow them. And this is a bit that I want to focus on a little bit more. So if we just look at the timeline, the Constitution of India came into force in 1950. In 1955, we had the second five-year plan, which was about rapid industrialization. That was the whole point of the second five-year plan. And this industrialization happened all across the terrestrial areas as well as on the coast. But it took till 1976 to formulate, to include the environment in the Constitution. And even then it was included as what are called directive principles of state policy, which are only guidelines. They're not enforceable. So you can't do much with them. They're just principles that exist. And even after that, it took another 10 years for the Environment Protection Act to come in. And another 5 years after that for the Coastal Regulation Zone notification to come in. So it has taken 44 years since independence for any legislation for the protection of the marine and coastal ecosystem to come into place at all. Now, this sort of, de facto, so basically there was no law that protected it, right? And this is a sort of dominant model that you keep seeing. So I want to give a quick example of this place called Sangumal, which is in Rameshwaram in Tamil Nadu. If any of you have been there, it's right next to this area called Agni Teertham. It's this fishing village. It's about a kilometer long. And this is a photo from 2012 that one of the fishing leaders showed us. And this is a like entire 1 kilometer stretch of land, all of which was used mostly by fish workers. There are about 50 families that lived there. And there were about the 25 villages that are dependent on this area. This next that I want to show you quickly is a clip from the same area in Sangamal in 2019. This that you're seeing is a water sports center that came up a few years back. I'm just gonna fast forward because it keeps going. There's expansion that's happening of the water sports center. This is now what remains of the commons that the fish workers can use. And that's about 100 meters that's left of the 1 kilometer stretch that existed. And this is a promenade that is being built by the tourism department in Tamil Nadu. And notice how there's like a wall on the other side, on the seaside as well. So the fish workers can't even pull their boats up on the beach. This, I'm going to fast forward because this just sort of keeps going and going and going. And you reach all the way to Agni Teertham, which is the original tourist spot. Now this this is Sangamal in 2008. And this is what Sangamal looks like in 2019. There is a promenade, as you can see, and all of the white buildings are resorts that are coming up right now. And you can see there's a lot of place that's under construction or is going to be under construction. and the yellow bit that you can see is what is left of Sangomal right now. Now, the thing is that all of this land belongs to the government. These are public lands. And they have all been leased to private companies to be used for resorts. And there is technically nothing that stops them from doing that. There's nothing, there's no law that says that you can't sell, that you can't lease out coastal land to private companies. There is something called a public trust doctrine, which is a principle which says that you cannot convert ecosystems, resources, natural resources for commercial use. But it is simply a principle because there is no act behind it. There are no notifications, there are no rules. There's nothing that turns a principle into something that actually works on the ground. So then what happens is that, you know, this sort of keeps happening and there's nothing really to stop it. And this is just one small example of one beach in Rameshwaram. But if this is actually what is happening across the entire country. Just a quick deviation. If I am going way too overboard and you need me to cut down or stop at any point, just like please feel free to just jump in and like make me stop. Okay, so here I want to come to what is now the buzzword of the 21st century, which is the blue economy. Now, the blue economy was initially seen as a way to talk about sustainability of marine and coastal ecosystems, because it was seen that there are a lot of resources. And as Trisha said, these are resources that are important, not just to fish worker and coastal communities, but to a lot of different people around the world. There is much, much higher dependence on marine and coastal ecosystems than we actually realize. But unfortunately, what has happened is that that has sort of the sustainability and this protection has sort of taken a backseat. Now, this is research that was done by about 25 different organizations across 5 different countries, India and Thailand and a few other countries in the Indian Ocean region. And if you're interested in marine diversity or even like marine governance and all of that, I definitely recommend checking out the website Blue Economy Tribunal. There's been a lot of extensive research that's been done. It's been led by fish workers, but it also has a lot of academics and experts who've come in and who've been part of some very extensive research. And what all of this research has shown that at the end of the day, it really comes down to two numbers, which is 24 trillion and 1%. That the ocean resources have a valuation of $24 trillion, but we have only taken out 1% of those resources. And that is sort of the basis for the blue economy right now. It is about how do we get this remaining 99% of the resources out. And in India, this has manifested in one way as the Sagarmala project, which talks about port-led development. And it imagines the entire country as one long industrialized zone. So you can see there are major ports and minor ports. And in each of the coastal economic zones, they're all seen as manufacturing clusters. So they will have textile industries, they will have paper industries, chemical industries, anything that needs export all sort of happens in these industrial clusters. And the Sagarmala project itself has more than 150 projects, and it's a 12 lakh crore project. But it's not the only one. There are a whole host of other projects. There is something called Swadesh Darshan, which is this, but for tourism. There is a smart cities project, which has a lot of coastal cities involved in it. There are a lot of World Bank projects. There are a lot of Asian Development Bank projects. So there are over 400, 500 different projects that are happening across the coast of India. And again, I want to come back to this idea that coastal governance happens de facto, because there is no legislation behind the Sagarmala. There's nothing to prevent Sagarmala. There is nothing to say that it's okay to do either. there is something called a blue economy policy, which came out in 2021. But Sagarmala has been going on since 2016. And many of these projects are already happening. So it's taken 5 years for even just a policy to come in. And this has a lot of real implications on people. So for example, in Vadhavan Port, there has been loss of livelihood for 10,000 women fish workers. In Gujarat, there has been extensive pollution where it has completely destroyed the Narmada River and the Gulf of Kambat. In Kerala, black sand mining in the Alappuzha district, the rare mineral mining, has led to major erosions. So I just want to take a minute to read all of this, which you can. And these are just a few of the examples. There are, like I said, there are hundreds of these projects going on in the country right now. And as sort of very bluntly, but very properly put by one of the fishing leaders, was Amla Chechi, who said that first they destroyed the forest and the land, and now it's the turn of the oceans. Just before I quickly finish, I want to talk about one place that is really precious to me, which is Lakshadweep. I'm sure you've all been hearing about what is happening with the Lakshadweep and with the Save Lakshadweep campaign, with the administrator who's there right now. And I think it's a very important movement that is sort of happening in one of the most fragile ecosystems in India, one of the places that are the most vulnerable to climate change. And I think what's important to understand is that what is happening in Lakshadweep right now is also part of the blue economy plans. So this is a table from a Niti Aayog project, which talks about converting Lakshadweep into paradise islands. And this document was brought out in 2019, but there's been work going on since 2017 on this. So it's a central government project. It includes building water villas, which are these like sort of hotel cabins, which are built inside the lagoon on stilts. And of course, the clearances for all of this are expected to be given by the administration itself. And it is expected that private land will be taken for this. So I just, I'm not gonna talk a lot about this. I just wanna put in there that I think there are a lot of things to be done. Primarily, I think it is high time that we move away from the executive. We need to start talking about rights. We need to start talking about the protection of the coasts. There are authorities that are supposed to be working around on the coasts, but primarily the Coastal Zone Management Authority works like an approval authority. There have been calls before for a separate ministry. So I just want to reiterate that as well, because currently coastal governance is split between three ministries. There is the Ministry of Earth Sciences. There is the Ministry of Environment and Forests. And there is the Ministry of Agriculture, because Department of Fisheries falls under the Ministry of Agriculture. And Trisha gave a few examples of technologies that can be used for sustainability. So I think just moving, including them into legislations becomes really important. And again, like climate change is the context for which anything happens in the marine space, because it is so critical to coastal ecosystems. So just to say that we need to go beyond what we have right now, which is just a national action plan and state action plans. So that's it from me. I just want to finally just end with saying that I owe huge thanks to a lot of people, and I am also just learning a lot of this stuff. A lot of it is very new to me, so I'm sorry for any mistakes I've made, anything I've missed, and thank you again for having me.
Thank you so much, Stella. That was an insightful talk. I mean, regarding all the complexity surrounding governance of our marine and natural ecosystems. Now we'll move on to the Q&A. If you have questions, you can either raise your hand and we'll call your name, or you can put your questions and then we can call out your name so that you can unmute and ask the question to our panelists directly. So I see one question that came in early. Bala Vignesh, if you want, you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Or I can just read it out here. If you're comfortable, can you, it'll be good if you can unmute and ask directly. Okay, I'll ask. He says he's studying BSc Zoology final year and he wants to do marine biology afterwards. So he asks, what are the good colleges in Tamil Nadu, especially for marine biology? Trisha, if you would like to go first.
Good question. I'm sure a lot of people have struggled with that same question. I think there are a few good institutes for marine biology in India. In Tamil Nadu, I think there's a Annamalai University. Apart from that, there's also the Pondicherry University, but the Andamans campus has marine biology. And there's also, I think, in Goa, you have a good institute for marine biology and oceanography. And if you're not too sure if you want to do marine biology and if you'd like to just keep your options a bit broad, you can also do a degree in something like wildlife or zoology and then specialize later when you work. So I think that's my short answer. Maybe Shruti, you have any suggestions yourself or Stella?
Yes, Stella, if you have any.
I haven't done marine biology, so I'm a bad person to ask for this.
So we have next question from Shruti. Shruti, you'd like to ask directly?
Yes, I was just wondering, thank you, Trisha and Stella, that was a lovely session. I was just wondering if in any of these cases have the prevention of the SCST, Preventions of Atrocities Act, or the Forest Rights Act been invoked in any of the cases for protecting the rights of the fisher community, especially in the case of the large ports, which is happening. So are there any examples of the community filing for claims or such things?
I'm assuming the question is to me. So I go first. So specifically about the SCST Atrocities Act, I am not actually sure whether it is or not. The Forest Rights Act has been used in certain river systems because they're sort of included, but in a lot of the coastal spaces, the Forest Rights Act per se doesn't apply because it only applies to forest areas. There was a fish workers' rights bill that was brought out, a draft came out in 2009, but there were a lot of complications with that, and then it just sort of got dropped and it's never come back on the table. But there are other ways in which this is being done. There are other laws that are being used. So in Mundra, for example, I know that they've used the Biodiversity Act. So what they've been trying to do is to have the area declared as a biodiversity heritage area, and to then sort of use that to say that you can't have a port here. In certain places in Karnataka, the Karwar port, they have, there's a case that's going on in the High Court. So there have been a lot of challenges, but a lot of these challenges, you know, it's a little bit of grasping at straws because the CRZ notification itself has been amended so much and it's allowed so many things in 2019 that it becomes a very difficult battle if you don't have a law that protects it. It becomes a battle of principles and it's not really a legal question so much anymore. So it then becomes very dependent on, you know, do you have a judge that shares these value systems or not at some level. Trisha, if you have examples working at Dakshin that you want to add as well.
To be honest, I don't have too much to add to this and it's not my area of expertise anyway. So nothing really.
Yeah, maybe next question, Trisha. Nicholas, he had earlier mentioned about, he was surprised about the shark consumption that you're talking about, like shark meat consumption and the amount. And he also has a question. So Nicholas, if you would like to unmute and ask directly, I think it's a very valid question that you've asked. Okay, then I'll ask it for him. He says, are there any other means of protecting marine biodiversity?
Yeah, so I saw your comment about the shark meat consumption, and yes, it is interesting. And I just want to say again, there's nothing wrong with consuming shark meat. It's not something that you should stop doing immediately. It's more about the scale at which it's happening right now that is a bit of the problem. And yeah, some of the numbers that I gave here, I think when I said 50 to 70,000 tons of sharks and rays being landed and sold in the country, not all of it is just for India. A lot of this is actually exported. It's sent in different forms to different countries where they consume it over there, or they use it to make different products. So it is used all across the world for many, many different reasons. Other ways to protect marine biodiversity, that's quite a broad question. I think depending on what species you're looking at and what the location, what the area, and what the context is, there's a lot that you can do that is not just the typical, you know, creating a marine protected area or doing things like that. Is just one of the ways you can do it. And I think one nice example that I would like to give is, if you guys have heard of the organization called Marine Life of Mumbai, which is a really, really nice initiative that was started a few years ago by a group of enthusiastic people in Mumbai who wanted to learn more about the kind of biodiversity found on the coastal areas, especially just the tiny things that you see on your shores, the beaches, the rocky areas that you see on your beach. They started to explore this, and then they started to take people on walks to discover these different kinds of biodiversity that you see and connect people, put people more in touch with the nature that's around them and get them to actually know what's found in their coastal areas. And that has sparked quite a big movement, and it's become really popular. And just by doing this, you're actually moving towards conservation of these biodiverse regions, because they also played a huge role in the whole coastal road that was being developed in Mumbai and trying to stop this whole thing. So I think there's a lot of different ways that you can take when it comes to preserving biodiversity and protecting it, or even raising awareness. It all adds up in the end of it.
Stella, would you also like to give your opinion? Like, what are the ways you can work towards conserving biodiversity? Like, what are the major places where you can intervene for better protection?
I think, like what Trisha was saying, I think this sort of being able to find ways in which you can find sustainable solutions that don't exclude people, but also, you know, allow for that. I mean, there have been a lot of examples where conservation organizations and people who are interested in conservation, ecologists, have been able to really work on establishing rules. So one example I gave was the seaweed collectors in Rameshwaram. But there have been similar initiatives. So for instance, in Lakshadweep, there is an island called Pitra, where there was a spawning aggregation of groupers that my ex-colleagues from Nature Conservation Foundation, they sort of discovered. And they've worked with the panchayat there to just pass a resolution that they will not fish on the reef 5 days a month for five months when the breeding happens. There is no fishing that's done on the reef. And this is something that is monitored by the community, that it's a rule that the community came up with, and then they sort of monitor it. So I think there is a lot of need now for ecologists, communities to sort of be working together. So I think that is really an important area to sort of come together and you know, ensure that this balance, this conversation happens.
Next, Sharanya, I see you have raised your hand. If you would like to go next.
Yeah, ma'am, I have a doubt about like how are marine organisms classified in?
You're talking about the way they're classified? Trisha, you would like to?
I could. I have a question. Like, why is the Neritic zone rich in life?
Okay. The way marine organisms are classified, I think there's no, when it comes to taxonomy and you know, the kind of biological classifications that you may have learned in school and college, there's no separate group that's for marine organisms specifically. But you find marine life that is across all of your the different phylum and families and all of the different taxonomy groups, starting from the lowest sponges all the way up to mammals, both in invertebrates and vertebrates. You have groups that have marine species, and you have groups that may be entirely marine as well, but many groups that are just a mix of marine and freshwater and terrestrial species as well. So I think there's no real specific classification for marine species, but if you want to get a sense of what the main groups of marine organisms are, I think in vertebrates, obviously fish, that is Pisces, would be the biggest marine and freshwater group. And amongst invertebrates, I think echinoderms are largely marine. Mollusks also, you get a mix of both marine, freshwater, and terrestrial. A lot of your lower groups, like the sponges and the coelenterates, are also quite made of largely marine organisms. And I think your second question was, why is the neritic zone particularly biodiverse? I mean, I think that's a bit of a tricky one. I don't know if I would really say it's the neritic zone that's specifically very biodiverse, but in general, you would find that coastal areas and more shallow waters, you would see a lot of a very high biodiversity. And there's no simple answer for this, but it's just largely because of the kind of different kinds of habitats and niches and things that these regions provide. Because of the abundance of sunlight, you have a lot of photosynthetic activities that can then support a lot more marine life. And that's why you generally see more biodiversity in certain regions.
Next.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Next, we have Namrata. Namrata, would you like to go ahead, unmute yourself and ask?
Hi, sorry. So I was very curious to know if there was anything being done to sort of manage the disposal of waste in our water bodies. When I say that, I'm not just talking about plastic waste, but also our sewage, industrial effluents, and so on.
Stella, would you like to take it first?
Sure. So legally, yes, there are restrictions on disposing waste into water bodies. This comes under the Pollution Act. I didn't go into that a lot. But one of the issues with this is that, so even though it's there legally, the Pollution Control Board is responsible for this. And the Pollution Control Board is so incredibly understaffed, underfunded. They're so overworked that most of the time they're just not able to take any action on this. So one example I have of this is effluent waste from shrimp aquaculture, which has been a major source of issue for like fish workers in a lot of places, particularly in Orissa and stuff, where what happens is that there is a lot of waste that's produced in shrimp culture, but there is also there are several cases that have happened that say that you cannot have shrimp culture in coastal areas. But what happens is that they keep happening, and periodically you'll have, you know, the Pollution Control Board or some other authority going and like removing prawn gherries in. So Chilica is one of these places where this happens. And the first order to remove shrimp culture in Chilica came in 1991 from the Orissa High Court. But even in 2020, there are still orders that are happening in the High Court that are saying you've not removed all the prawn gherries, so please go and remove all the prawn gherries. So then the Pollution Control Board and the Coastal Zone Management Authority will remove a few prawn gherries. 5 months later, new prawn gherries will come again. So this has been like a constant issue, and this has been a constant fight in a lot of places that I've worked in. And tourism is another place which contributes a lot, because a lot of the waste is also invisible. Like plastic is much more visible, but if some small hotel on the coast of Kanyakumari sort of puts a line and puts it onto the beach in Kanyakumari, which they do, it's not noticed as well. So there are legislations and there is action on the ground that people take. But it is, again, it's not a very, very, it doesn't happen all that much, as much as it should, I think.
Isha, would you like, I mean, the experiences in Malvern, which is a major tourist site, have you come across anything related to like problems of pollution and the way the fisherfolk or the community have dealt with it?
Yeah, so actually, like Stella had a really good answer for this. I mean, it was quite informative. I just have a few points to add to that. What I've seen from a more bottom-up approaches in Malvern and a few other places that I've worked in where, yeah, a lot of times, as she said, tourism can be a huge source of pollution. And just in terms of even on a much small scale, setting up all of these shacks on the beach leads to a lot of waste being dumped right in that same space that small-scale fishers are also operating out of and coming back and sorting their catch. So that can cause a bit of conflict. And I have seen some very small local-led initiatives by community members and the local council members and fishers who come together and try to clean this area up and try to put dustbins. And they've also tried to introduce initiatives like stopping plastic bags and introducing cloth bags instead. So there are a few of these small sort of ground level initiatives. Another interesting point I have to make is from Visakhapatnam, where there is another local, not even a law, but more of an agreement that was made amongst trawl fishers over there, where across the rest of the country, you have trawlers that tend to catch a large amount of bycatch, which is something I mentioned in my presentation. All of this extra stuff that they don't intend to catch, but all of the fish and other species, they bring it back anyway, and they sell it. And a large amount of that bycatch gets sold into fish meal, where it's processed and oil is extracted and so on. So this can be tons and tons and tons that are generated on a single day that are then piled onto a fishing harbor or on the beach, which is then sent for processing. But because of the kind of, I think there was some incidence of disease being spread because of the dumping of this fish in Visakhapatnam and all these other problems related to hygiene and pollution, that the local trawler boats and trawl associations actually came up with a agreement to not bring this fish back anymore, so they don't sell it over there anymore. And it's just something I've seen only in Visakhapatnam, nowhere else, but it's just an agreement that they made amongst themselves, and now they don't land this fish, they don't sell it anymore, which is quite interesting. And it's a bit of an economic loss for them as well, because they get money from this fish, but it's interesting to see that they've decided to stop selling it. So I think that's the only example I can give.
Thank you so much for that, Bharat. Yeah, Bharat had a question, and then I think we'll take from Ronika. Bharat, would you like to ask
a question? Yeah, Shruti, thank you. Thank you, Trisha, and thank you, Stella, for the wonderful session. My question is related to UN General Assembly in 2017 adopted a particular framework for countries to develop a sustainable and biodiversity conservation plan beyond their national jurisdiction. That is UNCLOS. So my question is about UNCLOS. Did India developed any conservation biodiversity plan beyond the national jurisdiction? And second is, I am hearing about using the marine life digital sequence information, like taking the genetic diversity into the labs where the countries don't have any control on the seas. So these two are my questions. I'm also asking because you see most powerful countries do have a lot of control where there is no national jurisdiction happens. So yeah, I think these are two my questions.
Stella, would you like to take that?
Yeah, sure. To be perfectly honest, I can't tell you a lot about it. So your first question was about UNCLOS, the UN Convention on Law of the Sea, right? So I'm not exactly sure what India has done in terms of beyond its jurisdiction. What it has done for its jurisdiction is things like it has restricted the entry of foreign vessels into Indian waters for fishing and also merchant ships. They're all licensed, they're all regulated. But yeah, honestly, beyond that, beyond the Indian jurisdiction, I'm not sure exactly what India has really contributed to. And your second question about the lab thing, again, I'm not very sure of this. The Biodiversity Act in India does technically give control to the Biodiversity Authority. to regulate what genetic material.
Okay, we've lost Stella. I think we'll give 30 seconds and see if she comes back.
City is gone, so I'm just going to keep my video off. But I was just saying that I forgot what I was talking about now. the Biodiversity Act. No, I was just saying that the Biodiversity Act gives the Biodiversity Authority, it gives it that authority. But one of the issues is that the Biodiversity Act, for some reason, hasn't really taken off in the terrestrial systems, in the marine systems as much as it has in the terrestrial system. So we're really still struggling with some of that. But I don't know a lot about the international laws related to this. So, Trisha?
No, to be honest, I don't really have anything to add here either, because I'm not too familiar with this.
Next, Ronika had a question. She had mentioned she had a question. Yeah, you can go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. So my question is that, does the damage of coral reefs cause destruction to the ocean? If yes, then how and why?
Tisha, would you like to go first?
Yeah, sure. So just to make sure I got it correctly, you're asking that if coral reefs are damaged, does that cause further damage to the ocean? Yeah?
Okay. Yes, ma'am. The question is about if the coral reefs are damaged, does it cause any destruction to the ocean?
Yeah. So, yes, I mean, definitely coral reefs are a very, very important species group, and not just a species group, but a habitat for ocean ecosystems. So this has been seen in many places across the world where corals are damaged by bleaching, for example, where once a coral is bleached, it basically loses its the plankton that is helping it photosynthesize, and a lot of the coral dies. And because coral reefs support such a huge biodiversity of marine life, from fish to sharks to all kinds of invertebrates to, like, I don't even know, like a huge diversity, it's quite a bad situation if we lose our corals, if they get damaged or bleached, or if they're destroyed in any way. It does mean that this whole ecosystem that depends on these corals will also slowly start to not disappear necessarily, but it'll start to change, and you have other species that may come in. You have a lot of the species that are originally there in this ecosystem may disappear. So coral reefs are definitely very important, especially in these tropical areas. I hope that answers your question.
Yes.
I just want to add to that to say that, like, coral reefs are also incredibly important for human beings because they are in places like the Lakshadweep, which are coral islands. The existence of the reef is the reason that there is drinking water available on the islands, for one, and the reason that cyclones and other things don't destroy the whole place entirely. So it's the reason that these communities exist at all.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Shalya, you had a question? Shalya, would you like to unmute and ask? Yeah. Shalya, are you ready to unmute, or I can move on to the next question?
Ma'am, I actually have a doubt.
Yeah.
Like, ma'am, what are the examples of the changes in marine and ocean ecosystems caused by the ongoing global warming process?
Tisha, would you like to take it first?
Yeah, so that's a very broad and interesting question. Yeah, when it comes to global warming and climate change, to be honest, there's still so much that we don't really understand in terms of its short-term impacts, its long-term impacts, and what it's really doing to both ocean ecosystems, freshwater ecosystems, and eventually even terrestrial systems. We don't entirely understand what's happening, but we do know that there are changes that have been seen. And I can't give you many examples. I can, but right at the top of my head, I can think, yeah. So one of the things that we are noticing is that as the water gets warmer, especially in temperate regions where water temperatures are generally lower and much colder than they used to be, because of this warmth, species are actually changing their distribution. So a species that were that was otherwise found in lower latitudes because they needed warm water are now shifting more and more north because the water is getting warmer. And then subsequently, the species that are actually found in these colder waters and that need these cold waters to survive, they're either declining or they have to move even further north in order to still get those kind of temperatures that they need to survive. And this is something that we see in a lot of fish. We've seen it in India also, where, again, we're not really sure and we can't necessarily say this is happening because of climate change, but that is one of the reasons or the hypothesis or one of the guesses, because we see species of fish like sardines that are also seeming to change their cycles and becoming more and more available towards the northern parts of the country and less available in the south. And it's hard to say why this is happening or whether it's a permanent change, but things like this are happening. So there's, of course, the more famous examples are of the polar bears in the Arctic, the penguins in the Antarctic, whose life cycles, breeding cycles, everything depends on the temperature and the presence of ice. And as that is melting, that's causing a lot of problems for them as well. So there are a lot of examples, but there's still so much we don't know. And there's a lot that we still need to learn about this whole process and its impacts.
Hello, would you like to add anything?
Thank you, ma'am.
Experience working with coral reef fisheries?
Yeah, sure. I mean, so mostly in the Lakshadweep, for example, the one example that I have, like Trisha said, it's not very clear what causes what and all of that. But one of the examples that the islanders themselves talk about a lot is how one of the things that has happened with coral reefs being there is that they've not been affected by cyclones, except in 2016, when there was a major phenomenon in the waters where waters across the globe heated up. I'm sure you've heard of the Great Barrier Reef being affected very badly. And so Lakshadweep was affected as well. And Cyclone Oki hit Lakshadweep really badly. So that is, you know, something that they noticed for the first time, because one of the first times that a cyclone that's hit the West Coast has actually hit the islands as well, because of how badly the reef was damaged. So yeah, there are examples here and there that are coming out. There is a group called the South Asian People's South Asian Action for People on Climate Change. Sorry, I'm not getting it right, but SAPCC, who have documented a lot of stories of how people have been impacted by climate change. So we keep hearing on all of the coasts a lot of people talking about fishers talking about how they can't predict where fish will be anymore because wind patterns have changed. And so they say their traditional systems of understanding where fish are, which are based on wind patterns, are no longer true. So you have these old people in Lakshadweep who are like, you know, usually we expect in August the wind will come from this side, but nowadays it just comes from somewhere else. So we don't know where to go. So there are some of these examples that are coming out.
Yeah, there's one more question in the chat box. Priyanka asks, can you tell us about some of the subsidies for fisherfolk in India? Are they useful for conservation efforts? And what are the gray areas? So, Stella, yeah, you'd like to go first?
Actually, maybe Trisha would like to go first. I haven't worked in fisheries a lot, so I have a very sort of herd idea of it.
Yeah, I don't have too much to say because this is not my area of expertise, but the little that I do know is that, yes, there are a number of subsidies that are available. For example, there are subsidies on diesel and fuel that are used by boats in order to, yeah, obviously operate and go out fishing. And this, first of all, a lot of these laws also vary state-wise. So there are some states that have certain subsidies, some that don't, and I'm not too sure of the complexities, but the places that I've worked in Maharashtra, for example, there are diesel subsidies that used to be there, but no longer exist. And there are a lot of subsidies, for example, in terms of, so the government in many states and the central government in general is now trying to promote certain types of fishing, like longline fishing and deep sea fishing, because they're now starting to realize that trawl fishing is not quite a good practice. So because of this, they're providing a lot of subsidies to boats. And I think this is happening in Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu as well, and a few other states whether providing subsidies to boats to convert these boats into longliners from trawl fishers, and a few other similar related schemes that are existing in order to promote longlining and deep sea fishing and reduce trawling. And in terms of how these impact conservation activities, I think, yeah, it's a bit complex because, for example, any kind of subsidy that obviously encourages any type of large-scale fishing is ultimately not the best, because initially it may seem like a good thing. Even things like longlining and deep-sea fishing, there's a lot of belief that they are less destructive and they're better than trawl fishing. And that may be true. They may be better than trawl fishing, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're a very good form of fishing on their own, especially if you provide a lot of subsidies and do it at a very large scale. They could have a lot of their own impacts. So it's hard to say if this is really a good thing. And in fact, I'm sure there's a lot of criticism of this movement, because eventually you're just transferring the problem from one to the other. So I think that's one example I know in terms of fishery subsidies and the kind of impacts that it has. Stella wants to add a bit to that.
Yeah, so like Trisha said, there are fuel subsidies. There are also subsidies that are given for making boats itself. There are loans that are given. So there are fisheries cooperatives that are made in like most states in India. Not all of them are very active, but they do give loans for making fiber boats and making fiber nets and things like that. In terms of conservation, yeah, I don't really have much to say in terms of how these affect conservation, because fisheries is not my area either. So
I think Sindhura had a question that Stella might be, yeah. Sindhura, would you like to go ahead and ask?
Yeah. Hi, Stella, and hi, Trisha. Thank you so much for your presentations and talks. Honestly, Stella, when I was listening to your talk, I was like, gosh, do I need to have a log degree to be a conservationist in today's age? But anyways, my question is related to environmental impact assessments. And I know that abroad, or at least in the European countries, you are required by law to conduct environmental impact assessments before and after the projects, and see how biodiversity changes. If there is important biodiversity in area, you're not given permits to conduct certain development projects. So I just wanted to know, is that the case in India? And do we have such regulations or practices?
Sure. This is a really good question. I definitely don't think you need a law degree for sure, but I think it really helps to understand how the law works in India. So in terms of environment impact assessments, there are two things in the coastal area. One is there is a CRZ notification that I was talking about. And one of the things the CRZ notification requires is a clearance. So if you want to construct anything at all, anything from just even a single toilet, which is not a permanent structure, technically you need a clearance from the Coastal Zone Management Authority, which is supposed to do this assessment of whether it is something that is okay to be built in that area. There is also the EIA notification itself. The EIA notification includes coastal industries like ports and other things as well. The way the EIA notification works is that it is a bit of a before and after. You're supposed to get a clearance before, and then you are supposed to have every 6 months, I think now they've changed it, it's every year now, monitoring reports which are supposed to be done. But again, one with the CRZ clearance, the main issue is that there isn't enough empowerment in terms of doing the assessment. So you'll see that in most CZMAs, they don't actually do field visits. They don't actually do any real assessment. It's a very sort of, mostly they just look at what is allowed in the CRZ and what is not allowed in the CRZ. And they don't do this like per thing. The EIA notification requires a little bit more. So these things are formed, but one of the issues again with the EIA notification is that the terms of reference that are made for doing the assessments, they're very standard. So you will see the EIA report that is made, there'll be one exact same report copy pasted in, Mundra in Kutch and, Karwar Port in Karnataka, for example, it will just be a copy paste of each other. And there's no sort of, there's no specific assessment of, you know, specific coastal areas that might be more vulnerable. There's no cumulative impact assessment, which I think is very important. So, and there are also a lot of industries that are excluded. So tourism, for example, doesn't need any kind of clearance, either EIA, it needs a bit of CRZ, but it doesn't need an EIA clearance. And this is one of the main things in the environmental law sort of movement. One big ask has been for better assessments to be done.
Okay, thank you.
It's
quite sad.
We'll take two more questions and then we'll move on to the final comments. So, Ronika, you've been raising your hand for some time now. Would you like to ask a question?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. It's another question. Sorry, ma'am. I didn't get you.
No, you go ahead. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. So it's another question about corals. It just popped into my head. Why do most of the corals grow in shallow water?
Either of you want to go first?
I can take this. So yeah. That is a good question. The reason that most corals grow in shallow water is that, if you may have read or heard about this, but coral reefs, they are organisms, they are animals themselves, and they have a symbiotic relationship with these special algae called zooxanthellae, which basically live in the cells of these coral animals. So while the corals are, as I said, they're animals and they do have some tentacle-like things that they capture particles and feed, but a large part of their food actually comes from these algae that are living in their cells. These algae photosynthesize and produce energy and food the way a plant does, and provides this energy and food to the coral. So now, obviously, for this algae to be able to photosynthesize, it needs sunlight, which is why you only generally find corals and big coral reefs in relatively shallow waters, because I think sunlight only penetrates up to 100 or 200 meters depth maximum in ocean habitats. So corals can't really grow in deeper waters than that. And you do have deep sea corals, but they generally don't have these symbiotic algae living in them. And then they are a bit different in the way that they feed and the way that they function.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, I just have a doubt.
Yeah.
Ma'am, what are the threats to marine environment like us? We must know about that.
Talking about the broad environmental impacts, or what is your specific question? Sorry, I didn't get it.
Ma'am, my question was what are the threats to marine environment?
Okay. Stella, you would like to go first, and Trisha?
Sure. I think a lot of it already came out right at the beginning. A lot of people said plastic. I remember with plastic, my memory is of interviewing this one fisherman in Kanyakumari who was talking about how they've been having a really tough time with getting any fish because they fish near the coral areas. And he's talking about how, you know, all of the corals are constantly covered with plastic bags and all of the fish die in those areas. So plastic is definitely one of them. We already talked about global warming. I think to me, these are some of the main concerns. A larger concern in terms of just the law and governance, I think, is that at least in India and also in a lot of other places in the Indian Ocean region, the marine ecosystem for some reason is just not given the kind of importance that terrestrial ecosystems are. Trisha spoke about this in terms of research, scientific research, and this is also true of the legal space that for whatever reason, it's just really not a very big priority. It's not as much of a priority as it should be because it is very, very, very integral to human life on Earth. And so I think just prioritizing it is the lack of priority is a big threat in itself.
Ma'am, and what do you mean by this? Might another doubt. What do you mean by land runoff?
meaning, I mean, Trisha, you'd like to take it, and then, or Stella?
You mean like pollution runoff from the land? Trisha, do you maybe want to?
Yeah, I think she's talking about erosion, runoff from...
Yeah, I think if I understood correctly, generally when you say the word runoff, it is sort of the, it refers to the erosion or the movement of some substance that is lost from land and is generally enters some sort of a water body, either the oceans or rivers or a lake. So, I mean, that's a, broadly speaking, yeah, what you would mean by runoff. And in the context of things like pollution or erosion, pollution specifically, runoff is something that is seen and used a lot when you have an agricultural space, like you have a land that is used for agriculture and a lot of fertilizers, pesticides, and a lot of inputs are put into it, for example. And this eventually gets washed out and enters local water bodies like rivers and streams, lakes, and so on, which then eventually reach the ocean. And they have their own range of impacts because obviously these are chemicals that have been added to agricultural fields that are now entering your water bodies. So that is one example of runoff. I hope that somewhat answers your question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
We'll take the last two questions. Nicholas has been raising his hand for some time. Yeah. Nicholas, you go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. My question is plastic are usually dumped into water bodies. So can we reuse plastic, or are there any other ways to use plastic or do anything to plastic? Any other way?
That's a great question. One of our panelists, who would like to go first? Stella?
I think Trisha might be better to answer this, but yeah, I think definitely reusing plastic, avoiding plastic, which is very much possible. So in a lot of places in India now, there are plastic bans. And in Bangalore, for example, in the lockdown, it has changed. But in Bangalore, for example, I remember a lot of restaurants and, grocery shops, they won't give you, they'll be like, bring your own bag, or even to restaurants, you have to take your own dabba and like fill it in that. So I think it's definitely possible to cut down on plastic. And honestly, it's been something for me personally that I've been trying to do for a few years. And it's not as hard as we imagine that it is. It's actually really simple to cut down on plastic. Trisha?
Yeah, I mean, I agree completely with Stella. As she said, reusing is good, but if you can just avoid it in the first place and not use that plastic, that's the best thing that you can do. Because if you don't use some plastic or you cut down on your own plastic consumption, that also means that there's eventually less plastic that is being manufactured and that is eventually entering the ecosystem. So that is the best thing that you can do by cutting it down in every aspect of your life as much as possible. Like, we all have our own limits and we all have certain things that we just can't avoid, but the things that you can avoid, you really should do it. And in terms of reusing of existing plastic, yes, there's a lot of work and development that has been done in that sector in terms of how we can possibly try and degrade this plastic better, make it more biodegradable, or just recycle it. So they've, from what I understand, they're even using plastic now to make tar, the tar that you put on your roads. There's some amount of plastic that goes into that. They are even using plastic when it comes to manufacturing of clothes, jeans. So you have a few brands that are using some small amounts of waste plastic and putting it into their fabrics to make things like jeans. And a lot of small products all across the world are now trying to use old and recycled plastic as a way to kind of use it up and reduce it from being dumped into the environment by putting it into other products. So that's one, that there is a lot of progress in that field.
Okay, thank you. I have one more question, last one. It's from Bharat. He asks, are there any laws pertaining to invasive species, especially in aquaculture? Fisheries, is there any law that governs introduction of invasive species in the Indian context, or the Fisheries Board or Biodiversity Board? Stella, you'd like to go first?
Again, fisheries is not my subject, so I'm not actually sure of invasive species as such. There are a few. I know that Kerala had something about the African catfish, there was once it became invasive, I think I remember that there was some regulation of it. There has been some regulation of certain kinds of shrimp species and stuff as well. That I know exists. The US and killer kind of shrimp, I can't remember the name of it, but there is a ban on its import from India. So they don't import that particular species from India. So there are a few of these things, but again, fisheries is not my subject. So
Vishwa, you would like to add anything to it?
Yeah, this is also not something I know too much about. But as Stella said, yeah, there are a few bans on certain species, but from what I understand, especially in the marine sector, there are not many regulations and things to prevent invasive species in the first place, but there are actions that have been taken when an invasive species has come and done some damage, and then they do action to try and minimize that damage. Like you have a few invasive species of seaweed that are commonly found around the coast, and then there's always like action done after the invasion to try and manage it. But in terms of any policies that prevent them to begin with, I don't know of too many, because a lot of countries like, especially countries like Australia and New Zealand, which are island nations, are very strict about what kind of products you can bring into their country, because they're very careful when it comes to invasive species, but we don't really have such strict protections in place from what I understand.
Thank you both so much for answering all these questions patiently. I think there are a few more questions. But if you'd like to add your email address to the chat box, maybe they can send the questions or contact you directly in case they have any more questions or doubts. Thank you so much to the both of you. I pass it on to Sudha for final comments.
I think before last who asked like questions, I'd request everybody to switch on their camera so that Bharat can take a photo and then. Okay, so the last two AHA slide questions, if you can answer, what are the key takeaways from the session? Can follow if you could answer, we will know what you've been able to get takeaway from the session. And it's almost been 2 hours, so very helpful. Someone. I think everyone's tired or okay, very, very helpful. Oh, that's good. That's great to hear. And I've got two answers. If I get two or three more, then we can go to the next question. Too informative. Okay. Great information about marine world. Okay, great. Very informative. So I think overall, everybody agrees that it was a great session. And we can walk away learning a lot more about the marine environment than we knew before. So I don't want to take too much time, so we'll go to the next question. So how do you think we can effectively engage in conserving our marine resources? So our session was entirely based on this, like most of the talk. So if you can get your answers for this as well, then it'd be great.
Ma'am, could you repeat what was your question?
The question is, how do you think youth can effectively engage in conserving our marine resources?
Okay.
So you can put in the AHA slide link that's been put in the chat box. We can see it.
Yes, ma'am. I've just checked it.
Yep. Read and spread awareness. Great. Create awareness is coming out as a volunteering, yeah, Trisha. Spread active participation, true. spreading awareness, effective participation. Okay, yeah. So I think. Raise our voices. That's also true. As Stella and Trisha has pointed out, they have pointed out raising our voices are important if you want to make a change. So I think I'll stop sharing.
It was totally an effective awareness.
Okay. So as a final comment, if for 1 minute each, Trisha and Stella, if you could tell us, like, as a youth, where do you think we can intervene to make a change for marine conservation? If you could let us know, because we have a youth position paper that we're creating. If you could let us know what are the main intervention points that we could raise our voice to make a change. So I think we can, Stella, if you would go first and then Trisha.
Sure. I think first of all, before answering that point, I just want to say that I am so thrilled with the way the youth in India is really getting into the environment movement and climate change. It is, even today, just seeing so many younger people, it's just absolutely so heartening and so amazing to see so many people coming together across so many age ranges. So I'm very, very thrilled, and I'm very like moved and touched that so many people are doing this. In terms of specific things, I think going forward in terms of the country itself, I think that there needs to be, like I said, a lot more legislation for coastal protection. We need to move beyond just the CRZ and talk more about coastal protection, marine protection in a larger sense. And there is a very important need for scientists to be working together with communities and fish workers and with the government at different levels. It has to be at the global level and at the central and state level and at the local level, working with panchayats and working with other local bodies that already exist. So I think that sort of discussion and that sort of debate that needs to happen across a lot of spaces, I think, is one. And I, again, like, just, I think that for me personally, I feel like bringing in ecology a lot more strongly into how laws are framed, bringing in ecology and rights is a very important space, which I think as our understanding of the ecosystem changes from this very limited space of it just being about non-humans and humans not being in there. I think that conversation changing is something that the youth can really lead on, and it's something that the coastal space really does need. And again, as some of it that came out, things like impact assessments, for example, are incredibly important. They're just not taken seriously enough right now, but they're absolutely core.
So first of all, I absolutely agree with everything Stella said, because those are definitely things that we need, especially in this country, in terms of the laws and policies, because they are so few when it comes to the marine environment. And just to add to that, I already said a few of these things in my talk, but one of the things I really feel that the youth especially can do and have the ability to do and the power to do is just to help connect people with their environment better, because a lot of people are becoming more and more disengaged from their environment, their surroundings, from the nature that once upon a time, like our ancestors and people used to know so much more about it. And I see that even in fishing communities, where with every generation, people are moving a bit away from fishing, they're moving into more lucrative sectors, moving out of the village and into the city. And not that there's anything wrong with that, but it's important that we don't lose that connection with nature. So I think one of the action points can be to try and reconnect people back to their nature, whether it's in a city, whether it's in any kind of space, because once people are more aware of their surroundings, more aware of the things that are around them, that's when they'll feel more encouraged or motivated to take appropriate action for that. So that's one way that you can even reach out to people outside the wildlife circle, outside of those who are already interested in wildlife conservation, and reach out to people beyond this to just ordinary people in the country who don't know anything about nature, anything about the oceans or conservation, get them interested, get them connected back to their environment again, and get them involved so that they can also take that action to make a difference.
I think that what Stella and what Tisha, what both of you have raised, I think are very important topic. I mean, very important, because I think examples of that, as you said, are the marine life in Mumbai, and even the student sea turtle conservation that works in the coast of Chennai. So before that, the final, I would request all the participants to fill in the feedback form that Shruti has put in. That will really help us. And thank you, Trisha and Stella, for spending 2 hours of your time with us. It's been a long tour. It's been a long session. We never planned for it, but I think we had a lot of questions from school and school students and adults as well, for professionals as well. So thank you so much for joining us for these 2 hours.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for organizing it so well. I think it was a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you to all the participants as well for joining us. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am. We filled the form.
Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. God bless you, ma'am. Have a great day ahead.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. God bless you, ma'am. It was a very great session. Thank you for joining us. Ma'am, I just have a doubt in the regarding this e-certificate. Like, if you attend the 5 sessions, only we're going to get the e-certificate, right?
Yeah, if you attend 5 sessions, you'll be getting the certificate.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Bye, ma'am.
Bye.
It was good session, Sudha and Shruti.
Thank you.
Thank you. I hope it wasn't too long
and too technical.